Thank you very much. I want to talk to you about the return of the house call. This is one of my favorite paintings in medicine. It's of a physician in the late 1880s caring for a child. And numerous people have written about this, but what strikes me is the intent with which he's caring for the child and where he is. The child has not come to him, but he has come to the child. Throughout the history of medicine, technology has fundamentally transformed medicine. In the 18th century, Edward Jenner developed the smallpox vaccine, which allowed us to prevent the unpreventable. In the 19th century, William Röntgen developed the X-ray and took this picture of his wife's hand to allow us to see the invisible. In the 20th century, Sir Alexander Fleming developed the first antibiotic, penicillin, to let us to cure the incurable. And the gift that we have for the 21st century is that Steve Jobs and others have developed technologies that increasingly allow us to reach the unreachable. These technologies will be critical to our treatment of infectious conditions like the Ebola virus, but will also be increasingly important to address the rising tide of chronic conditions that increasingly will affect all of us. Currently, 140 million Americans have at least one chronic condition, and these chronic conditions account for over 75% of healthcare expenditures. With the aging of the U.S. population and populations around the world, chronic conditions will only increase in their prevalence. In 2005, we estimated conservatively that in the world's most populous nations, there were 4 million individuals with Parkinson's disease. And in the span of just one generation, the number of individuals with Parkinson's disease in the United States and around the world will more than double. The challenge is that many of these individuals with Parkinson's disease and other chronic conditions cannot access care. In the United States, over 40% of Medicare beneficiaries with Parkinson's disease do not see a neurologist. Over 40% of Medicare beneficiaries with Parkinson's disease, a common neurological condition, do not see a neurologist. In New York State, as you can see on this map, there are areas of New York State right here that where over 50% of individuals with Parkinson's disease don't see a neurologist. And we know that individuals who don't see a neurologist for their Parkinson's disease are 20% more likely to fracture their hip, 20% more likely to be placed in a skilled nursing facility, and 20% more likely to die. What can we do? We can use the same technology that you're using to communicate with your children and grandchildren to use that technology to communicate with your physician. In essence, we're bringing back the next generation of the house call. So how many people here ever received a house call? How about any clinicians here who actually performed house calls? So we're trying to bring, technology actually ushered out the house call. In the 1930s, 40% of all encounters between a physician and a patient took place in the home. And the rise of the automobile and the complexity of medicine drove care back to the institutions. Now we have the opportunity using telecommunications technology to take care back to the home. 7 years ago, a nursing home in New Hartford, New York, population 20,000, right outside of Utica. Anyone from Utica? A few people from Utica. Contacted us and said, we have about 50 nursing home residents who have Parkinson's disease and no neurologist to care for them. Would you care for them? My colleague, Dr. Kevin Biglin, did what we think was the first house call into a nursing home to care for someone with Parkinson's disease. Mr. D was an 80-year-old man with Parkinson's disease who was having behavioral problems, was trying to climb outside the window of the nursing homes, was belligerent to the nursing staff and to his fellow residents. He was on a medication that was making his thinking worse, and he was actually on a drug to make his thinking better. Dr. Biglin took him off both those medicines, made some further adjustments to his medicines. His score on a standard cognitive exam, which essentially asks you what today's date is and where you live, went from 21 out of 30 to a perfect 30 out of 30. His behavioral problems disappeared. He became a model citizen of the nursing home. 2 years later, we took that exact same model and said, how about providing care to people like Mr. D directly in their home? The first patient I ever saw was an older man who lives only 30 miles from Rochester, New York, but it was becoming increasingly difficult for him and his wife to come see us in clinic. So when I said, "Would you like us to see you virtually in your home?" he was game. The second visit he ever did was in his kitchenette. He was sitting on a chair, and his wife's in the background making soup. Based on those experiences, we conducted a small pilot randomized controlled trial randomizing patients with Parkinson's disease who were seeing Dr. Biglin or me to continue to come see us in clinic or for us to see them virtually in their home. We asked three questions. The first, are we crazy? Is it feasible to deliver care to grandma and grandpa with Parkinson's disease directly in their home? It turned out that more of the virtual visits were completed than the visits in person, and one person actually got in a car accident on their way in to see us in clinic. The second question we asked is, are we going to provide vastly inferior care? And it turned out that on measures of quality of life and Parkinson's disease, both care models seem to improve care. And the third was, are we providing any value to patients? So we asked patients to time themselves from the time they left their home to the time they came to clinic here at the University of Rochester to the time they returned back to their home. And it turned out for a simple 30-minute follow-up appointment, patients were spending over 4 hours of time for a simple 30-minute appointment with us. By contrast, we said, well, time yourself from your time you turn your computer on, the time you turn your computer off, and turned out they're only spending 53 minutes, and 3/4 of that time is spent with the patient, with the physician. Turned out each virtual visit was saving patients and their caregivers 3 hours of time and 100 miles of travel. So we've taken the same model that we've used to deliver care into patients' homes, and we've gone nationally. Principally through care and research visits, we've connected to patients in 38 states around the country. We had a research grant from the Michael J. Fox Foundation, which enabled us to connect to research participants with Parkinson's disease who wanted to contribute to the advancement of our knowledge of Parkinson's disease, and let us do that by seeing them directly in their homes and their communities, rather than them having come to a medical center. We've extended that same approach to care for individuals in over 20 countries on 6 continents. Some of the patients I care for live in Panama, and although Panama is a wealthy nation and has 15 neurologists to care for 3 million people, it doesn't have a single Parkinson's disease specialist. By contrast, the University of Rochester right here has 8. In 1962, President John F. Kennedy set a bold goal. He says, "We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade, not because it is easy, but because it is hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we are willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one which we intend to win." Let us today here on Meliora Weekend set a similarly broad goal. Let us say that anyone, anywhere in New York State with a chronic neurological condition, be it autism or Alzheimer's disease, MS or ALS, can receive care. For the history of medicine, the care you receive is largely dictated by 2 factors. The first was who you were. Were you the right age? Were you the right sex? Were you the right pigment? Were you the right creed? The second was where you live. Did you live in an area where you were able to access care? Let us today, for the first time, say that for a defined group of illnesses, for a defined geography, that anyone, anywhere can receive care. Meliora.